Hi, welcome to Digital Principles and System Design. In this video lecture, let's discuss about binary codes. When we use computer systems, we not only process the numbers but also process non-numeric data. Say for example, I'm using PowerPoint to present my lectures, which is non-numeric. I can store the names of the students. Or suppose if I wanted to store the traffic signal lights, red, green, yellow, that is also non-numeric. So how do we store the non-numeric or numeric data with binary bit patterns is what is binary code. So when we use binary codes, how many bits we will require to represent individual elements in the system? What is the system? Say suppose if I am taking the traffic signal as the system, we have three different elements: the red signal, green signal and yellow signal. Okay, so the capital M will be 3. So how many bits will be required to represent this M elements in the binary code is the question. Can we use an arbitrarily long number of bits? That is not possible. I am interested only in the minimum number of bits. Why? Because if the number of bits I'm using is more, then I will require more space in the memory to store the element. So we will be interested only in the minimum number of bits. So how to calculate that minimum number of bits? Small n. So we are going to represent using binary code. So the base of the binary is 2 to the power small n, the number of bits that is required, that should be greater than or equal to the number of elements that we wanted to represent. If we are able to satisfy this relationship, we can get this small n. So if you take log on both sides, we get n equal to log m to the base 2, which is sealed to the upper value. That is, suppose if m is 3, as in the case of traffic light, we will get log 3 to the base 2, which will be around 1 point something, right? And I should get the seal of 1 point something, which is 2. If I get only 1, I mean if I discard the fractional point, then with one bit I can represent only two elements. Bit 0 will represent one element and bit 1 will represent another element. So we have to take the seal of log m to the base 2. For example, to represent the symbols in decimal number system, how many bits do we need? We know that there are 10 symbols in the decimal number system, so m is equal to 10. 2 to the power n should be greater than or equal to 10. So if you take log, it should be log 10 to the base 2, it should be 3 point something. The seal is actually 4. So without taking the log, you can substitute n is equal to 3. So n is equal to 3 is 2 to the power 3 is 8. In that case, this equation will not get satisfied. So when you get n is equal to 4, you have got 16 in one end and in the other end you have 10. So 16 is greater than or equal to 10, so the relation holds. Therefore, the minimum number of bits that will be required to represent any decimal digit is 4. Now let's consider how many elements can be represented using n digits. Suppose if we are given the decimal number system and we are using 2 digits, so r power n will be 10 power 2, which is 100. So with 2 digits, how many different numbers can we represent in decimal number system? It is 00, 01, 02, etc. up to 99. So totally we have 100 different elements. That's what it says. Take any n digits in some number system with radix r, then we can represent r power n distinct elements using n digits. And sometimes we might not use all m elements, which is the maximum, which is r power n. We can choose some small m which is less than r power n also. For example, consider four elements. To represent four elements in binary, that is radix 2, we will need at least 2 bits. So n is equal to 2. So what are the combinations? We have 00, 01, 10, 11. We can also represent four elements in binary number system with n is equal to 4. That is, I am going to use 4 bits instead of the minimum 2 bits. In this case, we have 16 different representation. That is, at the max, r power n is 16. Out of that, we are choosing 4 representations to represent each of the element here. So, the first element we represent using 1 in the least significant bit. Rest of them are all zeros. The second number we represent by a 1 in the second bit position, and rest of the bit positions will be 0. And similarly, the third number will be represented by a 1 in the third bit position, and so on. And this sort of representation is called one hot code. And the choice of choosing, how we choose this representation out of 16 different binary patterns, gives us different binary codes. So let's see how we can represent the decimal digits using binary codes. So as I said, when we use 4 bits to represent each of the decimal number or the decimal symbols, we have 16 different combinations. That is, 16 binary bit patterns we have. Out of that, we need only 10. So if we choose 10 out of the 16, okay, there are 8008 different ways. That is, 16 choose 10 equal to 8008 different ways of forming the binary codes. But we are not going to see all those 8008 ways, which is useless as well. We are going to see only few useful things. Okay, so the decimal number symbols are from 0 to 9, and we have these many useful representations. 8421 code is also called binary coded decimal, because this bit patterns, if you see, it is very similar to the representation of the decimal numbers in binary number system. But what is the difference between the binary number system and the BCD? In BCD, we have only 4 bit patterns. We will not go beyond this one. And 0 will be represented by this 000, and 1 will be represented by 0001, and so on. And this is a weighted code, because each bit position has a weight associated with it. Say for example, 5, if you take the decimal 5, it is represented by 0101. So the corresponding digits, if you add here, the weights if you add here, it is 4 plus 1, which is 5. So it is a weighted code. Similarly, you have another weighted code, 2421. Here, we represent 0 with all bits to be 0. 1, we will represent the least significant bit position as 1, rest of them are all zeros. 2, we can either represent using 1000, or I can represent like 0010. But we choose 0010 as the representation of 2 in this weighted number system, 2421, although we can write it as 1000. Why the choice of 2 is 0010? We have a specific reason that I will come and discuss later. Similarly, we have say for example 7, I have the representation 1101. If you add 2 plus 4, it is 6, 6 plus 1 is 7. Okay, so this is also a weighted code. 8421 minus 2 minus 1 is also a weighted code, and it is an example of negative weights in the weighted binary codes. And in this, how do we obtain 1? We obtain 1 by subtracting 2 and 1 from 4. So 2 minus 3 is 1. So we will get 0, 1, 1, 1 as the representation of 1. And 2 we can get by subtracting minus 2 from 4. So that is 4 minus 2 is 4. So we get 0, 1, 1, 0. And similarly 5 we get by subtracting 3 from 8 and so on. And all these three are called weighted binary codes. The next code is XS3 code. XS3 code is named as XS3 because the XS3 code is obtained by adding 3 to the BCD code. Okay, that is the BCD 3 will represent 0 in XS3, BCD 4 will represent 1 in XS3, and so on. So that is why, since it is 3 more than the BCD code, it is called XS3 code. And if you see the properties of this 2, 4, 2, 1, 8, 4, -2, -1 and XS3, they share a property called self-complementing code. What is self-complementing code? Okay, the 9's complement of the decimal digit can be obtained by the 1's complement of the number. What does it mean? What is the 9's complement of 1? It is 9 minus 1, which is 8. And how do we represent 1 here in 2421? It is 0001. If you simply obtain the 1's complement of this representation, you can get the 9's complement of 1 in 2421. That is, if you simply flip this bits, so we will get 3 1's followed by a 0. That will be the representation of 8 in 2421. Similarly, if you obtain the 9's complement of 3, you have to simply flip. So it is 1100. What is 9's complement of 3? 9 minus 3 is 6. If you see 6, you can see it is 1100, which is just the 1's complement of 3. Similar property you can verify in 8, 4, -2, -1 as well. Say for example, this is the representation of 3. So 6 should be 1010. So 6 is represented as 1010. Take any number. So what is the 9's complement of 8? It should be 1. 9 minus 8 is 1. So it should be 0 followed by 1111. That is the representation here. Similarly, in XS3, take any number. Say this is your 6. 9's complement of 6 is 3. So if you simply do 1's complement of 1001, you will get 3. So you should get 0110. That is the representation of 3 in XS3. So these three codes, 2421, 8, 4, -2, -1 and XS3, are all self-complementing code. And self-complementing means the 9's complement of the decimal number can be obtained by 1's complement of the number represented in that self-complementing code. And the next representation is gray code. In gray code, if you observe the successive representation, you can observe only one bit position change. That is, from 000, when you go to the next number 1, only the least significant bit has changed. Everything else have remained unchanged. If you consider from 1 to 2, the second least bit position only changed. No other changes are observed. Similarly, when you go from here to here, the change is only in the least significant bit. What is the advantage of such systems? When you have analog system and the system is very gradual in changing, the number to be recorded will be coming in succession. So if you have such system, the any change in the system, when you change from one number to the other number, will not cause any confusion. What does it mean? Okay, see, when you represent the binary code, each bit is represented by an individual circuit. So whenever there is a change in that particular bit position, that circuit will operate and bring in the change. So when you have 4 bits, you will have 4 different circuits associated with each of the bit, and when there is a change, there will be change in the corresponding circuit. That is, the circuit will operate and produce a change in that bit. But if you consider the independent circuits, they might have independent delays. The delays might vary between the bit positions. And say, for example, we wanted to change from 3 to 4. And suppose if I am using the BCD number system or the binary coded decimal, suppose if I wanted to change from 3 to 4, how many bits are changing? This is changing from 0 to 1, this is changing from 1 to 0, and this is changing from 1 to 0. So 3 bits have to change. That means that 3 circuits will operate. Suppose this is the slowest operating circuit, this is better compared to this, and this is the fastest, say, for example. Now, to change from 0011 to 0100, since this is the fastest one, we will get it like 0010, which is this number. And next to this, this is better operating, so this number will change. So we will get like 0000, which is this number. And finally, this will change from 0 to 1 and we will land here, which is the actual number we wanted to land. But if you observe the circuit in between the transition from 3 to 4, you are transiting from 3 to 2, from 2 to 0, and then coming back to 4. So you will not understand what is the state of the circuit. But rather, if you consider the change from 3 to 4 here, the only change is in the third bit position. So either the system will remain in the state or it will transit from, any one of the state, either it will reside in this or in this. We will not have any confusion coming in between the transition from 3 to 4. That is the advantage of using the gray code. Now, we should not confuse the conversion and coding. What is conversion? Given a decimal number, suppose if I wanted to convert to a binary number, then we have to repeatedly divide this number by 2 and represent the number. And we will write the remainder from bottom to top and represent the binary number. If it is coding, then this is a symbol in decimal number system. This is another symbol in decimal number system. And we have bit patterns which will be used. So one will be, suppose if we are using a BCD number system, one will be represented using 0001 and 3 will be represented using 0011. So I have to simply say 1 is represented using 0001 and 3 is represented using 0011. And this is coding, and we should not confuse between the conversion and coding. And if you see this one, in all the things, out of 16 binary patterns, we have chosen only 10. Okay, so remaining six patterns are unused numbers in each of this number system or the binary codes. Now, when we have non-numeric data, we have ASCII code, which is American Standard Code for Information Interchange. So, we have 7 bits to represent each of this entity. So, we have B5 to B7 represented here. We have B1 to B4 here. So, since it is 000 to 111, we have 16 entries along the row. And here we have 16 plus 16, 32 plus 1 space plus delete. So, 34 control characters. And we have some special characters which counts to 32. Okay. And we have numbers from 0 to 9, 10 numbers. We have English alphabets, capital A to Z, small a to Z, and so on. And these control characters, we don't use it directly. It is used for the transmission purpose, say for example acknowledgement and negative acknowledgement, and we have ACK, or this is cancel, carriage return, all those form feed, all those things. Okay, these are used mainly for communication. And these special symbols, suppose if I wanted to represent US dollars or operators, then we will use these special symbols. And for representing any decimal number, we will use this one and the English alphabets. Totally, if you add them all together, we will have 128 characters represented in BCD. And ASCII code is a 7-bit code. If you add one more bit in the MSB, we can have 8 bits together. 8 bits together we call as a byte. So, we can use this 8th bit for any special purpose. Say for example, if I wanted to use two different fonts. If I represent 0, it can be a normal font. And if I represent 1, I can represent the element in italics. Something like that we can use. And how do I get this ASCII code? Yes. Yes is here, okay. And the MSB is 101 and the least significant bits are 0011. So we write it as 101 followed by 0011. And R is just one element above. So we have 101 followed by 0010. That is what is given here. So, when we use the 8th bit for error detection, then we have two choices. One is the even parity, the other is the odd parity. So, what is even parity? Even parity is when you count the number of ones in the message along with the parity bit, it should be an even number. So, when you have yes, when you count the number of ones, it is 4. So, you will add 0 as the parity bit. And if it is an odd parity, the number of ones along with the parity bit should be an odd number. So, already we have 4 ones here. We will add 1 so that we will have 5 ones in the message, which is an odd number. Similarly, if you consider the representation of letter R, for even parity, we have to add 1 so that we will make the number of 1s to be 4. And if it is odd parity, we will add 0 because we have 3 1s in R already. So, it is an odd number. So, how do we use this as a error detecting code? Okay, suppose if I am sending this letter from one place to another place. So, the place need not be far away. Suppose if I press yes in the keyboard, so it has to be sent from keyboard to the memory. So I am transporting S from keyboard to memory. This is also a transportation. So at that time, the memory and the keyboard will agree on what parity to check before the transmission itself. Okay, that is a standard one. Okay, assume that they have agreed on even parity. So when we press yes along with this one, one more zero is added and sent to the memory. Suppose during the transportation, this bit 1 is changed from 1 to 0. So in that case, the number of 1s will be odd. The memory will count the number of 1s and it will find it as odd. And since it has already agreed on even parity, it cannot have odd number of 1s. So it will say, whatever you have sent, I haven't received properly, and it will send a negative acknowledgement and the keyboard will send it once again. So this is how we can detect the error. We cannot correct the error though, but we can ask the sender to resend the information once again. And this type of parities can be used to detect any odd number of changes in the bit. Suppose if this bit is changing from 0 to 1, then I'll have a 1 here, right? Now I cannot detect because this has changed to 0 and this has changed to 1. So here I will not be able, because when I count, I will have 4 ones and this is an even number, I will not be able to detect. But if this number also has changed from 1 to 0, then I can detect it. So again, I will result in only we have this one and this one, 3 ones, which is an odd number. So this we can detect. So any odd number of changes we can detect using parity bits. So this is all about the binary codes. In the next video, we will see the Boolean algebra, the relation between Boolean algebra and digital logic. And thank you for watching the video.